I wanna De nuevo aquí, Rodríguez Pati. Tú sabes qué cosa es el tacatá. ¿Te gusta el tacatá? A mí me gusta cuando las mamitas hacen tacatá. ¡Tacatá, bro! Mío también. Sí, mami.
Friends, gamers, Overwatchers, welcome back. It's the Overwatch Watchers Brawl. It's season 4, and we've got our 9 p.m. game coming at you. It's 3.007, and he's back with the glorious Sir Waltham.
For those of you in Central Time, my doggies, it is our 8 p.m. game, as I am in Central Time, but happy to be back once again. Going to be having the teams of Obsidian, as well as Off the Map, going to be playing here tonight, this evening, whatever your preference for time phrasings are. We're going to be expecting some pretty good play coming out of both these teams tonight.
Yeah, what do you even say, like, time-o-centric? Like, I got ethnocentric, like, I got that one down. Mm-hmm. Not personally, I hope, but, like, time-o-centric, it could even be morning for some people, Sir Waltham. Someone could have woken up on the other side of the planet, one of these 29 people, one of which I know is me, tuning into the stream. So for now, let's give them what they came here for. Waltham has a fantastic little pregame interview for y'all.
Yes, I do. I have Caustix. He is the CEO and founder of, I believe it was Unchained. Is that correct, Caustix?
That's correct.
Fantastic. Glad to have you here with us this evening, I'm going to go ahead and say. How are you feeling today, tonight, this evening?
Pretty good.
Right on. Now, this is, if I'm not mistaken, the first time you guys will have been in this tournament, Unchained Obsidian, that is. How are you guys feeling?
We're feeling pretty good about it. We typically host community pokes, varying ranges from like gold to top 500, and we do hero ban, so it's something we're slightly accustomed to, so it looked really interesting to play.
I feel you. That means you guys are going to have a little bit of the game mode edge, perhaps, in your coming games. A lot of teams coming in here not having that hero and map ban experience. Look forward to seeing that. Now, what made you guys decide to kind of hop into this tournament? Just kind of wanting to get out there or just have a little bit of fun? What's you guys' reasoning behind this?
Well, I personally have been in the Watcher server for a few months now. I've considered gear tournaments in the past, but we've mostly been an open division team, and we've been pretty busy with that, but scheduled times fall in line with pretty much our scrim time, so.
Well, hey, two birds, one stone, right?
That's exactly.
Certainly way to get it done as well. I'm going to be casting these games for you guys. Don't know if you normally cast yours, but it's always nice to have more teams kind of get their names out there. I like seeing the whole wide swath we got going out here. Now, as you may have heard in our chats and all that good stuff, we are going to be having an MVP vote. And I always like putting the pressure on whenever I first interview a team for the pregame. I'm going to go ahead and put all the pressure on you. You pick one player from your team. Who's somebody to watch out for consideration of the MVP? You can say yourself.
Well, obviously myself. I'm just kidding. I would say probably keep an eye out for Shogunai. Mm-hmm. He's our top SR player, and he definitely shows it.
Well, fantastic. I know the viewers at home are going to be excited to see that, as we're going to be starting to pop off here in just a second, so I'm going to go ahead and send you back to the team. But Caustix, thank you for coming around and just goofing with us for a little bit, having a few words. Greatly appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. Good luck out there. Now, Threep, once again, second time tonight, we're going to be starting off on Hanamura, and given how we saw the first time go around between Team Urgency and the Toronto Tide Pods, how do you think this set is going to go? Do you think it's going to be a little bit more one-sided like we saw out of the first set?
So I made some what I now see as rather outlandish claims previously. I claimed that if you could surpass the gauntlet that was point A, then you would at least be a contender on the map of Hanamura. Then the Tide Pod says, but yeah, like, what if we did the map so fast we gained time? So like, yeah, that's cool, Tide Pods, GG. Like, well done, or sorry, good round at least. Well done there. So I'm going to stick by my statement. In even matchups, and I'm not saying that Urgency was not a good matchup against the Tide Pods, because boy, was that a hard match. But looking at this one here, it's a 2CP map. The statement stands. You either get the full hold on point A, or you open up point B and all hell breaks loose. Now, then for the follow-up offense, the same point sticks. It's either going to be a full hold, we're done, good round, moving on to the next map, or, you know, a bunch of different situations can play out. But the fact of the matter is this opening offense either busts past point A or we're looking at a very simple situation for that next round, so to speak.
Yeah, I certainly couldn't have said it any different myself. I'm going to be a little bit curious. We don't have a whole lot of information on Unchained Obsidian here moving forward. They are a little bit, as I mentioned, they are a new face in terms of team participation in this tournament. A couple of them, I'm sure, sticking around the server for a while. However, off the map, esports going to be a little bit more prolific here. Did very well in open divisions, apparently claiming People's Champion. We'll see if they get the People's vote in Twitch chat later, though.
Yeah, I am genuinely excited. It's rare that we get to see such an incredible matchup here. We have, on one hand, we have OTM Esports. On the other hand, we have Obsidian. Both of them looking like very solidly matched up teams overall, in my opinion. This should be a very, very fun match to play with. Now, on defense already, we're seeing the Winston. We're seeing the Winston without the Reinhardt. And for Hanamura,
It's interesting, especially on that defensive pick. Not going to be seeing the Mei, not going to be seeing the standard Reinhardt hold at the choke. And this composition right now, it's interesting on the attack.
Yeah, they're going to have their work cut out for them for sure. But here we go. Razor already setting up. Boom, there's the Symmetra onto the point. Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. That's the way you want to run that strategy. And with that setup there, it's going to be very difficult to unseat them because you're coming right into the cannon of many bullets. With a Torbjorn turret to throw into the mix, and that was one of the fastest team kills on Hanamura you ever did see. 30 seconds in, point, hook, line, sinker.
Yeah, man, that was so blistering. I didn't even see Clankmeister on the point until I think I was focusing on choke. I turned around, and I still don't see Clankmeister. They got to that point instantaneously, and when you're dealing with a comp that works well stationary, you need to be quick at setting up as efficiently as possible. And man, that was pretty fundamental how to play this composition.
Yeah, now bonus round box 6 does actually get taken out by the fire strike from Feel Sod, man, very quickly. So that's a little bit of damage that's not going to be here for this push. And yeah, it does look like OTM's going to be backing off for the time being.
Yeah, interesting death there by box 6. But interesting note here as well, there's not going to be a main or even an off tank for the side of OTM. I wonder if it's going to be difficult for them to buy space without that, without really heavy pushing DPS or a good tank to kind of maintain that space.
So Clankmeister's going to be making that decision for them a little. He's actually going to be jumping onto the point as that point pressure was given by Symmetra. Saltshaker, though, goes down to Snafu, so that's another major surge of damage gone, but Clankmeister's... Wow! Torbjorn's ultimate grabs Feel Sodman and Caustic's huge! Even gets the D-Mech onto D.Va. Ugh!
Yeah, and one thing of note, Cam really doing well to kind of distract with these sim turrets. Once you get, like, you know, three different threats, throwing those sim turrets down really just going to amplify the damage that's really going to be thrown onto the point.
Saltshaker actually even switches onto the Doomfist just to get back in time, but Razor having set up onto the high ground means that it's pretty much a lost cause. Snafu's going to try and do what they can, but the round is done. The time has been gained, and OTM takes Hanamura at a similarly blistering speed that we've seen.
Yeah, Obsidian going to be very, very pressed to perform as well as that. I'm always a little bit pleasantly surprised when we see these sim comps come out and it takes off. Not so much in the fact that I don't expect them to work. It's just that a lot of teams aren't willing to put in that coordination, in that effort to getting the sim to properly move her team in ample time. Because a lot of times it's, you know, you put the teleporter down and then the first person will go in, and then 3 seconds later, the last person's going in, and that leaves a lot of opportunity for one of those targets to get caught out. And, you know, overall, it can be a bit tetchy, but I'm really liking the way it's being utilized by OTM.
Yeah. So, 5:46 left on the clock. OTM doing that great, solid push there. Let's see if that translates onto defense. Based on what they're coming out with, though, I think they have a concept in mind, a strategy, if you will. And I think the strategy is bullets. And the one thing that you have to remember about every Overwatch hero, no matter where they come from, no matter what their class is, the natural predator, bullets.
Yes, indeed. That is going to be perhaps one of the biggest causes of death in this game. And, you know, I mean, with the exception of Cam, pretty much an entirely bullet-based team from the defense here. However, still going to also be stationary. And if they could run this on defense as well as offense, it's going to be amazing.
What?
Some insane positioning from Razor.
Razor getting up into one of the places that you figure that teleporter location would have been found by a bug report by now. Shogunai is going to pick Razor off before they have a chance to do anything super crazy, which is interesting because that actually gives them enough time to get back to point, assuming that they can keep them at bay. But instead, it's actually looking like Obsidian, who are doing a very good job at murdering OTM for their audacity and their arrogance.
Yeah, and I mean, when you play that risky of a play style, yeah, sure, it can get a lot of BM potential. It can have a potential to do a very forward hold, but it comes at an incredible risk, especially when that Bastion is basically consolidated just by themselves. It's a high risk, mild reward.
So now here we go. It's actually Clankmeister. Look at Bayur and Clankmeister. They're taking the teeny tiny super sneaky route back down here on the backside. And now they've got the backline, and it's Heisenberg out of mech who's going to get taught by the turret. Clankmeister hammers Snafu to death, and this push is very crippled very early on. The turret in the backline grabs Executioner. Box 6 gets the rest of them. Shogunai is going to grab Saltshaker on the way out. Bayur going to die with a very quick respawn, or at least a distance. And look at those turrets set up. This is going to spell, I think, the tempo for the hold here.
Yeah, this just continues to be a weird fight. Badger going for that res on the Torbjorn. Post de facto seems just out of place, but when you get the results that you're getting right now, I'm not too sure they're going to be bitter about it.
So, yeah, and Cam even setting up the barrier where they did, it does stall them in the point long enough so that they did stay there. And so, again, they have a massive time bank as well now to deal with as well, Obsidian, with 6 minutes. And, yeah, they're doing a job. Snafu grabs Clankmeister, but again, the defense is playing so far forward. OTM is going to get respawned before a, you know, take on the point can even be made. Cam flexing seriously onto Symmetra, establishing very concretely why she was moved into the DPS category.
Yeah, this forward hold is very bold. It's kind of the same situation that we saw with the Bastion, but it doesn't seem to be getting punished as much. But I say that and the kills are gonna start coming through maybe for the offensive side.
I think the issue here too is that any kill for the defense, for OTM, means that it's gonna be just as long for Obsidian to mount any kind of attack. And again, the spawn advantage being so crucial. And even Box 6 is going to throw out the sights and he's going to grab Heisenberg before they can get back into mech. Also going to find Snafu with some clusters. So, again, and we even have a switch onto Roadhog from Clankmeister. When you stuff them like this, you have, even if there's a full wipe coming out, you have a chance to get everyone back on the point before even attempted progress is made.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that they're really kind of trying to do that ballroom blitz style play. Ooh, Caustic's getting shut down fatally early.
And even the Widowmaker, so Sawshaker on the point too, gonna grab Executioner. It's just, yeah, as long as kills keep coming in for the defense here, it's the ultpocalypse needs to be coming from Obsidian for them to have a shot at this.
Yeah, and I think Obsidian also needs to work on their regrouping. Overall, we've seen that it takes kind of a little bit of time for them to get going in terms of when one person dies, they will keep fighting this fight. And as we can see, OTM's still going to be pressing this advantage very hard.
Even with the kills coming out from Shogunai on the Hanzo with the dragons and a nice little pick there, Clankmeister actually does do a reset, so I think there it is. Nope, Box 6 is actually just sitting up there waiting on top of the spawn.
Yeah, not quite sure what the plan is. Maybe trying to get a flank. Feels sad, man. Almost getting dropped off the map by that Doomfist.
Yep, there it is. Box 6 finds Shogunai before they can leave spawn, and so that means once again the push is going to be initially crippled. Bayur also having some fun with the Tracer, a hero you don't often see, but in terms of burst damage potential, Snafu can attest.
Yeah, and I can only feel pity for our camera guy. I cannot imagine the amount of like directions he's having to focus in just this massively scattered team fight, because that's kind of what it is. We talk about how, you know, maybe OTM a little bit more skilled in terms of at least the badge, you're getting a massive pulse bomb, but being a little bit more proficient in terms of just raw mechanical skill. And when it breaks down, if it's disorganized like this, mechanical skill is all it takes.
Yes, and that's going to be the issue with, again, we've seen a lot of ultimates now come out from Obsidian, but it's the miss of ultimate, it's rather the lack of a fight-winning ultimate commitment that was missing. You can break out of this spawn cold, but there needs to be a Junkrat Tire class of kill here. You need that 4k, the 3k, you need to completely break it. Killing Razor, good start. Grabbing Kleikmeister, even better. So now with Heisenberg leading the way, I think we might be seeing Obsidian finally starting to move into the point with 2.5 left to make a statement.
Yeah, and that was really kind of what they needed. But we'll see if they can really go on to continue to capitalize, because there's still so many different directions of damage coming through for all these players. It's still tough. It's still not over.
Yeah, and Razor reset. Again, the spawn advantage huge. Razor's back on the Bastion. He's back at the point. Feels solid, man. Was doing some great work. Box 6 is even going to toss the other. He dies very quickly, though. So now Snafu doing some seriously good work. But again, spawn advantage on defense just so huge. If you can play Hanamura like this without reprisal, we could be looking at another 2 minutes of stuffs. The ults are there, but they need to be activated in a coordinated fashion.
Yeah, and this is so unfortunate for Obsidian, because they're basically having to play a mini game of assault here. They have to get the first easier with the advantage of coming out of spawn win just to get through the second half of the map. And then once all the respawns have come in for OTM, they have to retake the second point now that the respawns have come in. So it's like they're having to win two fights, one of which they're still disadvantaged with, one of which they have a slight advantage in terms of respawn. It's tough. It's real tough with the aggression that we're seeing OTM play with.
But Shogunai picks up the Widow Duel onto Bajir, who activated his sights a little late into the game. Caustics now with that barrage is uncontested from the Widowmaker, and D.Va, they have a chance to come in here without any reprisal, but there's actually a verticality to that Torbjorn ultimate, and Caustics actually dies to it as they try to float above the point. They're not able to get in. They are going to get res though, and so now we're looking at some serious action from Obsidian.
There we go. Yeah, we're going to be seeing now the tides start to turn as it is. Bastion ult going to be coming out. See if it nets anything. And indeed it is.
The Bastion ult finds Executioner. That's the target focus you like to see. As long as Mercy's alive, it's going to be a problem. Salt Shaker goes down to a pile drive from Feel Saad, man. And Bajir picks up the deficit in the Widow duel. Razor also finding Heisenberg after the D-Mech. The point is clear of Obsidian members. There's one ult on the table, and as far as attrition goes, the odds are kind of stacked against Obsidian right now.
Yeah, it does look like OTM is going to push that far forward. However, that would kind of be the case when you're running now Cam on this Reaper. You definitely want the team to have to push into you, and then you just get that massive barrel stuff potential, but even still, the Reaper going to be going in guns blazing.
So Reaper has two shotguns, and that's crazy. Like, I wish I could play Doom with two shotguns, and it's going to be the two shotguns leading the last-minute charge into Hanamura's defensive line, where point A went very quickly, point B went very long, and I'll bet it was agonizing for Obsidian, who are going to be going into map two with, I think, hopefully, a lot of food for thought.
Yeah, there is certainly a lot of notes to take away from here if you are Obsidian. And man, this team, it's so hard to like just objectively look at that and say there were some good points, because it was looking really rough for Obsidian. They did get some progress, which is something they could definitely be, you know, less than depressed about, because you know when you're getting fully held that aggressively, I think that would just crush a team if they made no progress. But even still, it's pretty tense, I gotta imagine, on that side of the comms.
And I suppose in another side of that situation, you think, did Obsidian actually get pulled into OTM's pace? OTM was playing a very squishy and very DPS-heavy composition. As much as I despise seeing it run, 3-3 actually kind of counters that super well, especially if you possibly even go double shields with the Winston instead of the typical Zarya. But Zarya bubbles also work super well. You have a lot of damage prevention, you have a lot of sustain, maybe even throw in the Moira and the Ana. There's no D.Va to counter either of those heroes, and that could be the switch or the choices that forces the switch from OTM. Instead, Obsidian tried to play OTM's game, and I think that's where the big full hold comes into massive disparity in terms of, well, yeah, there wasn't even an attempt at point B. They barely even got through the Sakura Blossoms, so to speak.
Yeah, and you said it perfectly. Honestly, from the side of OTM, I felt like I was watching a game of Quake. There were so many brawls going on. It was all over the place, whereas Obsidian definitely seemed to be playing Overwatch, where the roles were more defined and a little bit more traditional. But in the end, I think that when you try to play a team comp in a way that is so split up, like OTM was really kind of able to pressurize Obsidian into doing, you see that composition, that really supposed to be disciplined comp, really just kind of fall apart. And, you know, your DPS aren't backing your tanks up, so your tank shields get shredded anyway. Your supports can only focus one person or one set of teams if they're divided in two, whatever the case may be. And from there, it's just, how do you handle that?
Yeah, you do have to make a decision at a certain point. And over 6 minutes, you know, the decisions were made. And you could have gone to the traditional 3-3. You could have gone, you tried to fight OTM at that Quake style gameplay. And it didn't really work out for you. Now, what lessons are we going to be learning going into map two? It's that OTM has a very solidly mechanical gameplay. Can you counter that kind of DPS heavy nonsense with some good solid Overwatch? You absolutely can. The map choice is going to factor into that pretty majorly. Now, OTM has already banned Gibraltar, which is interesting because you actually kind of... Gibraltar is actually a decent map because that full court press can come to actually kind of bite you in the butt on Escort, based on what we've seen so far. So, yeah, I'm super curious as to how Obsidian's going to come out, because they get to not only select the map, but they're also going to be able to ban a hero. Now, granted, based on what we've seen of OTM, I'm not even sure what hero you ban.
Yeah, and I honestly don't even know if I can say that map choice is massively important here. I think that OTM going to be a little bit more comfortable when they can play multiple angles and all that kind of stuff. As we've seen, they're able to really kind of vulturize the enemy team and just pick apart piece by piece where they need to go. But I think that ultimately it comes down to play style being the issue here versus map choice, because OTM coming out with a comp I would not have expected to be as dominant with. That it was Bastion, Sim, Torb. That is some comp level stuff right there, where you don't really expect it to be as efficient as it is. It looked really practiced, even though it's being fought in such a scrimmy way.
Right, and you figure there could be some kind of back cap sneakiness you could do with some of the hybrid maps, or possibly with a straight escort map. It might honestly be in OTM's best interest. Again, I'm sure they're capable of running a wide variety of compositions in play. So, do they actually have a preference? Possibly. They did very explicitly deny Gibraltar. Did they have to deny Gibraltar? Nay, they could have picked anything from the quantity of maps. So was it a random pick? I don't know. That being said, yeah, it's a tricky situation. Obsidian's probably thinking how they're going to counter it. And ooh, there it is. Obsidian going with Hollywood.
All right.
How interesting.
All right, Dreep. I have some high-level classic Waltham theory crafting here.
I love it.
They ban Gibraltar because it's the most dive friendly, and dive forces the entire team to just jump and focus on one target. OTM doesn't want that. They want to be able to focus multiple targets each individually. They want to go with the maps that don't enforce dive as much. That's my high level big brain, peanut sized brain picks or theory there.
All right, I'm gonna be throwing at you the runt of the peanut family, then. My brain's gonna be tossing out there with the Torb save. They just wanted to eliminate him. No, that doesn't even work. Gibraltar's a great Torb map. So I'm done. See, there it is. But there is actually going to be a side switch. OTM, it turns out, does at least have at least one preference. They are going to insist on starting on defense for Hollywood. They are having saved the Torb. Now, we've seen some pretty mental stuff coming out of a lot of teams here, Aptix Esports. We've seen the mind games come out from them. So with the save onto Torbjorn, I don't really know what that says to Obsidian. If I were Obsidian, though, and I'm looking at Hollywood, there are a bunch of bans that you can actually throw out here that make it possibly a little crazier. Ooh, and it looks like they are going to ban the key factor of what used to be the key factor of Bunker Comp Orisa, but Baptiste is playable, and Orisa's not the only one with a big shield.
Indeed, curious to see how that's going to shake out. That being said, if OTM wants to earn my vote as like the most entertaining thing to watch, I want to see how this team kind of runs a Hammond with this comp, because their comp already feeling very scrimmy. I feel like Hammond going to be very good at kind of scraping that together. Disregard the fact that I main Hammond most of my life. I just think it'd be a cool pick to see out on the field, you know. But seriously, Hollywood, not the worst map. There's quite a few different kind of lanes that can go through, especially in Streets phase. You have kind of three different paths you can take depending on how far along the cart is. Not always as viable as one another, but we'll see how it goes. Wondering if the Orisa is going to be that crucial. That likely means we won't see as strong a bunker comp. You did mention that, you know, other shield tanks are available, but I don't know how much I can necessarily put my faith in a Reinhardt or a Winston to necessarily do the job that Narissa can.
True. I also think then that by extension means that what we are going to be seeing from OTM on their defense is possibly even more of the same. Or again, maybe so now we're getting into the debate state, and at least the casters have something they can fall back on. The players, unfortunately, a little more pressure. So props to them for engaging in this tournament with all their might to bear. However, I get to frivolously say, was Torbjorn a real save? Or maybe they're legitimately gonna do it? Like, man, I don't know. I get nothing. Fortunately, however, we do get to see OTM's defense comp coming out a little earlier than offense. So my uncertainty is, and I stalled for enough time for everything.
And it looks like Clangmeister gonna be feeling perhaps comfortable enough on the Torb. Still, yep. Waiting to see if they're going to be rolling out of spawn with it.
They left. They're all gone. So this is the composition, and as previously seen on Hanamura, it is a very damage heavy comp.
Again, it's the classic kind of situation where they might be just trying to break up a fight enough to really get scrimmy with it, and if that's the case, then we're going to be in a show here.
Yeah, Clankmeister even going so far as to set up so close to spawn that he is literally going to get picked before anything happens. Saltshaker even gets caught by Shogunai. He gets eliminated so fast. Clankmeister even takes him down, though. It's a one-for-one, a quid pro quo situation. Snafu grabs box six. Bajir, however, gets executioner. The defensive kills are just too... It's a full court press all over again.
Yeah, OTM definitely going to be setting the precedent for themselves. They are going to be now known as the aggressive team. Anybody out there reviewing their VODs, definitely going to know that they might be expecting them right out of the gates. That being said, that's perhaps something they may want to save as far as information goes for later. And Razor almost getting caught out.
Yep, Fiosad man is going to get taken out by Box 6. We have another far in the sky. Snafu is here and ready to rock. But Box 6 is deadly. Razor going to find Executioner as well. But, Caustix finds Razor. And if they can capitalize on this with their spawn advantage, that could be big.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, the spawn advantage is still going to be a little bit strong here for the team of Obsidian. But that being said, they have to kind of get those kills to come into effect first. And right now it's looking a little bit tough.
Yep, Shogunai even going to be picking up Box 6. So yeah, the stagger from defense is going to be real. And there's going to be a lot riding on the shoulders of OTM, but are they up to the task? Possibly. Cam going down, not going to be good. And a dragon's even coming on, going to stop the rest of them from even making that entrance. Heisenberg finds Razor. Snafu finds Bajir. Bajir is going to kill Caustix in his death. But that's going to be a mostly solid point take. Not quite.
Yeah. In most cases, it is the possum that plays dead, but the badger, in fact, doing it this time, coming back from the grave to strike back a little bit. But that being said, this is still some pretty decent stall we're coming and seeing from OTM. Not going to stall for too long. 4 minutes 40 left on the clock here for Obsidian.
My new favorite thing about Hammond is the fact that he has two very fast firing cannons and still got most of those kills with just whacking them against them, implying that we haven't aged as a species technologically at all in the slightest.
No, but still just us slugging people with various bits of metal and wood. However, speaking of massive amounts of metal, Razor throwing out the whole hog.
Yeah, and that's going to be followed up. Box 6 actually switching onto the Widowmaker, picking up Snafu. Shogunai goes down, feels Solidman is going to get res, and Cam, having swapped onto the McCree, possibly to do a little bit more of that hit scan goodness, is going to be aced by an Icicle to the head. Here comes that deadly Torbjorn Ord from Clankmeister. We've seen what that can do, so don't scoff at it.
Yeah, feel Sodman really trying to put the pressure onto this Widow. And again, that kind of baits it into the style of playing in the way that OTM are very comfortable playing with the one-on-one-on-one-on-one-on-one continued style. However, Razor going to be playing the first main tag I think we've seen out of OTM.
Yeah, this might be the sign of a swap. It is. Bodger is going to go onto the Baptiste. Salt Shaker having picked up the Reaver. Box 6 is not going to get out alive. He's going to get doven into Oblivion. And with 3 minutes 20, Obsidian is making very fast time, 4.2. Though now, Cam still on McCree. Clankmeister on the... yep, here it goes. Bodger is going to pick up Snafu.
Yeah, and Feel Sodman looking like they're going to be using their mines just as a little bit of a zoning ult there. Just trying to keep people away from the cart, trying to keep it as uncontested as possible. See if it provides any use. You got to see the kills coming through for Cert.
Yeah, and the Mercy Hammond composition working out very well for Obsidian. Even the... Well, no, he gets the dragons off, but Shogunai even goes down as a result. So it's going to be interesting. The point control has been set up, was set up by OTM, but instead there's going to be back and forth kills, but a barrage grabs with Box 6 and Razor. Obsidian looking very confident on this attack with... Hang on. No, it's all gone.
Again, it's going back and forth. When the team fight was very consolidated, as we saw, Obsidian starting to look good. That Hammond, the Hammond Wrecking Ball mines that really kind of kept OTM confined to that one area, really kind of allowed the different characters to play together. And we saw it looking a little bit more even. We saw the kills going back and forth, but as soon as the fight was breaking out, as soon as those mines went down and OTM able to really kind of spread out, you see that advantage come through that we saw in Hanamura, that even we've seen a little bit on first point and we're seeing here now, clearly.
So there it is. Bodger is going to pick up Snafu yet again, so it's an even 5v5 right here on the point. Spawns coming in pretty quickly, though, for both sides. Clankmeister finding Executioner. Feel Sodman going to grab Salt Shaker before they get eliminated by that McCree. Cam doing some solid work building up to his next Deadeye. Shogunai getting very low. They're going to get out.
Yeah, it's going to not be Cam deciding to take that peek, and instead just going to be backing up, regrouping on the cart. Not necessarily the worst call there. You don't want to get picked off and have a man down into the coming fight. But I really like this positioning from Badger as well as Box 6. The high ground, I talk about it all the time. I can't get enough of the high ground. It really enables you to get some lethality with those hitscan characters.
And bonus round, Razor having switched over to the Tracer, but it looks like it's almost going to be a little too late. They do get focused down very quickly, and a Genji Blade from Caustic's going to be making all the good stuff happen. A bit of a spastic action from Schultzinger going out, who goes nuts, does get eliminated. Rock 6 going to be finding Caustic's. I think this is a little too late, as with 2:20 left, the High Noon comes onto the point right as it slides into point.
Yeah, Cam going to be getting a lot of kills there. However, he does end it with that High Noon, meaning it won't be up for the next fight. It might be important if they continue to stick on the McCree, which it looks like they will. But overall, this McCree has been doing just such a good job of doing the DPS, kind of disregarding everything else. And there's no shields on either side to really mitigate any of this damage coming through, most notably.
And so here we actually have a little bit of that, what we were talking about earlier. It looks like Overwatch is being played against a deathmatch composition. The kills are coming in for OTM, but it's an overwhelming advantage. I shouldn't say overwhelming. That's actually the literal exact opposite of what's going on here. As once again, OTM baits the caster real hardcore style. Even Heisenberg goes down before they can adequately get their May ult off. Executioner does get the res on the Caustics. They're going to die for their sins, and we're moving right on to this defense with Razor back on the Bastion.
And I really kind of like this pick. I liked the pick coming out of Heisenberg. The Mei has some very strong 1v1 potential, especially since you can be frozen for a second and a half or 2 seconds, something along those lines. And it can be so frustrating to just have to sit there and watch a Mei send an icicle through your face, but still just not able to capitalize on the chaos quite enough. In that instance, Badger doing really well to keep the team up using that immortality field like it should be.
I'm going to shout out to Caustics here, going after Bodger very quickly and grabbing that pickup amazingly. Like, again, it's a huge source of healing. Badger's going to get out before anything really has an option. But wow, the Sonic Air is going to find out the Widowmaker snafu, grabs Cam. Looks like this town wasn't big enough for the two of them. Feels the odd man, it goes in. Caustics picks up the box six. It's a bit of a clap back, literally, from Clankmeister, who slams Caustics into a wall. Razor, however, going to get that Baptiste ultimate in there, and that's a lot of damage coming in.
Yeah, it certainly is. However, that amplification matrix not going to be finding too much in terms of lines of sight, as we're going to be seeing the attacking team kind of take that left-hand path. However, they only got 15 seconds to regroup here.
So it's interesting, I would normally call that a zoning Deadeye somewhat sarcastically. It actually looks like that was a very good zoning Deadeye, forcing everyone to the right side and getting some kills up for the defense. Now, another high noon comes out from Snafu, who's alone on the point! And Razor picking up Executioner, but what does it matter? The payload's moving! And so it's Box 6 dueling Snafu on the point, kills coming up for both sides, now Caustics with the Dragon Blade. But Salt Shaker, he's in Wraith form! He's gonna survive long enough for Cam to pick up the kill, and overtime is just but spent. We're done with this push.
Yeah, and I think that overall this push looked a little bit stronger than what we saw on, or this defense looked better than what we saw on Hanamura from Obsidian. Overall, I think that, you know, it's nothing to sneeze at this point. A lot of Hollywood has some difficulties. You get towards the back end of the second point, you get towards the back end of the third point. Those are the most notably hardest parts of this map to kind of conquer, and to their credit, Obsidian able to conquer at least half of them.
Really, really, really solid. Awesomeness. Now, the payload, it stops right here at this tasty little choke. Now, as far as final holds goes on Route 66, or blah, 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 we're playing Hollywood, dum-dum. As far as final holds go on Hollywood, that's a pretty solid place to have your defense set up for that final point, should it get to that point. Mm-hmm. I think Obsidian can assume from OTM at this point is they are going to be coming out guns a-blazing. And I think they're geared up, set, and ready to counter that. Heisenberg is back on the May. Good, solid option for stopping people as they come through the choke. I'm just curious if OTM is going to be grouped up long enough.
Yeah, I like this composition already. Because Cam on that Somber, you might think 5 DPS and a support. That's not even a main support. Could be very powerful. However, as the switch comes out, I was going to talk about the impact of health kits and how they're playing such a brawly style. But even I get jebaited sometimes. Three, don't feel too bad about it. And oh my goodness.
Well, yeah. So does Cam, apparently. Because the Cluster Rockets finds them very quickly, thanks to Mercy being able to give that boost when the projectile is fired and then move on to someone else. So that is going to prompt a switch. Bajir is going to be jumping onto the Mercy to get a little bit of that damage boost and goodness of their own.
Yeah, indeed, and I am just curious to see how it goes. Saltshaker doing a very bold Wraith teleport right onto point. Bold considering you're walking, or you're potentially teleporting right into a massive amount of damage.
So I see what Cam is going for now. It's the 360 no scope goodness, and he, or scoping goodness at least, but he's finding it. Heisenberg looking low. He does get the headshot. Razor setting up close to the point. He has the tank, or the rather, sentry configuration ready. And yeah, it's going to be a very early setup from OTM on the point, with led by Cam just murdering with those body shots.
And the hard part here, excuse me, my throat is dying. When you get Razor on the cart, if he chooses to stay on the cart, how do you deal with him with just a Hammond? It's going to be difficult. You're going to feed him a lot of ult charge if you just try to body block as that Hammond. You need a D.Va, or you need something with a lot of shield that allows you to close that gap very quickly. Maybe a Roadhog, since there's no shielding in this composition. Using a Roadhog to deal with Razor might be the option in this scrappy style of play anyway.
But Bajir even going to be picking up the kill into Shogun. I feel Sodman also goes down. Kills still popping up for OTM. The Widowmaker is out in the form of Snafu, but they're almost too late for the game for it to matter, as Box 6 eliminates so many of the tanky members. Heisenberg goes down. Again, not going to be able to bring that mail to bear until the cart moves into a more desirable position. But even Shogun I going to be cutting on out. There's nothing you can do against that Bastion.
Yeah, and that is a tough spot to be in, but we're going to be seeing the High Noon come out. Not necessarily sure what that was all about, but it seems to have done a job of kind of keeping the enemies at bay for the time being.
I want to emphasize that the zoning Deadeye seems to really... Even Snafu! Can't find Snafu! I can't even believe that happened! That was unbelievable! You have to get 3 McCree shots in rapid succession. Executioner was busy with some other fens, and they are going to get killed in the Widowmaker. Meanwhile, Heisenberg, however, doing a lot of solid work. Feels solid, man. Even goes down. Death by another kill. Razor's just kind of sitting here waiting for someone to enter his range as Cam... with Widowmaker, hilariously of all heroes, moves the cart, but now feels it looks like Obsidian's finally going to be contesting this progress.
I finally understand. After watching that entire play, Box 6 was the tank that they needed, was the tank that the attacking team needed. Buying so much space, preventing so many people from pushing forward, and really just allowing the team the necessary cart progress, or at least the cart presence that, you know, you need on offense.
Yeah, so Heisenberg dies. They throw out the May ult onto the point. But unfortunately, no one's left to capitalize, and point B gets taken with just under 5 minutes left, and there's a bit of a split spawn. Snafu on the Ash is going to get bullied a little and ultimately eliminated as they recover, but Shogunai now showing up on the Widowmaker, going to be eliminating the Salt Shaker option. So Box 6, again, kind of leading the charge here. Heisenberg even switching over to the McCree. Caustix is going to, however, have a bit to say about that. So Razor on the Bastion, not on the cart. Nay, he's actually doing very far forward work. He's even going to pick up Feel Sad Man. Bodger going to get a really ballsy res, doesn't get punished for it. So instead, we're seeing the cart move very slowly into this choke point. And now we're at Obsidian's last minute to make a final stand. Salt Shaker still sitting up on that Reaper. A Death Blossom had been spent, so now they're going to have to go into the next run. Box 6 goes down with Deadeye. Could be bad for the push here. Shogunai even finding Clackmeister. And despite Razor clapping, there it is. There's no one there. And the cart moves in, and Hollywood is done. No one on the cart left for Obsidian to make a stand. Razor having cleared everyone off, and that's going to be the cart just moving forward with little to no resistance.
Yeah, that Valking Mercy trying to get onto cart, just not quite able to get there. But in reality, with the exception of maybe some massive pop-off, coming through from that Flying Mercy, I believe it was Executioner.
Yeah.
There's only so much you can do in that situation. Like, I mean, no shielding, no D.Va, Bastion just tearing through you. That's like getting hit by a Mack truck and a steam train at the same time from two different directions.
That sounds really painful, actually, so I'm going to stop imagining that. But, so moving on, though, don't forget to call out your MVP of the match, because honestly, there's a lot of good stuff going on. There's even a little bit of that Widow duel action going, so maybe you like some of that. Moving on, though, we are going to be back into the hero ban, map ban phase of the tournament, and with map 3, this is match point for OTM Esports. Obsidian coming back, at least on defense, pretty nicely. Their offense was very nice. They almost complete Hollywood. They're not able to hold back a very vicious OTM Esports. Again, I feel like they're getting suckered into that DPS-heavy game.
Yeah, and it's interesting, because we can't even gauge how they would perform against any of the other teams here, because I don't think I've seen a team play this... I use the word scrimmy a lot, but when I say, like, scrimmy, I mean, like, this is what you see in a skirmish before you go into a comp game, where you're just sitting around in a blank server. You got tank mains, you got support mains, all trying to play McCree, Soldier, Widow, Hanzo. I'm not sure if OTM even has a tank player on their team at this point. I think I saw Razor hop on Reinhardt for approximately 45 seconds, but they didn't even really need to seem to utilize that. OTM just pulling out some wacky stuff here, and it's driving me mad, if I'm being honest.
Yeah, so maybe, you know what it is? Maybe it's because they're rocking. It's not just that they have the Chengdu Hunters icon in unison. It's literally the spirit of the Chengdu Hunters, who have literally said on multiple occasions, you have no idea what we're going to do, so that's our strength. And it's, okay, yeah, no, I'm kind of with OTM on this one in that regard. So Cam, speaking for OTM, is going to ban Horizon Lunar Colony, which Sir Waltham and I, despite being intelligent, handsome, and eloquent, have differing opinions on the map, but the fact of the matter is we're not going to be seeing it, and Obsidian immediately has selected Li Xiang Tower.
Yeah, and that's perhaps a risky gambit for this team. King of the Hill, or control point maps like this, King of the Hill style, as I like to call them, really, they are perhaps the friendliest to just the most deathmatchy style of gameplay. Because all you have to do is win the team fight and then just take point for free. Like you don't have to fight on point. It's kind of the game mode where it's the most optional. And that kind of plays right into OTM's hands. And I don't know if Obsidian kind of understand that. I imagine that they have, you know, a fair grasp of all the map modes. I'm not here to try to insult them or anything like that, but I do think they need to be very careful because OTM in a very good position considering how they're playing right now.
I can only 100% agree. The sheer deathmatchy nature of a King of the Hill map is pretty prevalent. And I can only assume that Obsidian, I have never seen them play a control map before. I can only assume that they have a big plan in action. Razor, however, saving Bastion means that, again, are we doing mind games based on history? No, they're not. They saved Torbjorn and then immediately played him. So, like, I don't know, man. Like, what's your game plan? Is it mind games? Yeah, honestly, kind of probably. Lijiang Tower does not lend itself to Bastion play. However, in the current meta, neither do the other maps. So.
Yeah, and I think that maybe if you want to get rid of one of those kind of cheesy characters, if you're Obsidian, you might want to go with the Torb. We've seen Clankmeister play it pretty consistently. You know it gets some use on that command center map with the where it's very interiorized. There's a high hitbox, so sometimes you'll see some aerial units run. And there's a lot of potential for that Torb to kind of take that high ground and then drop down, and you have to suddenly fight one character at two different locations with his turret. Especially when he pops his E. Doesn't look like they're going to go that way, however. It looks like Orisa once again going to be the pick that gets kicked out of the map.
Kicked out of the map, speaking of which, Bastion. They were selected, but Caustix is actually going to be banning Orisa, which I don't know how often people go snooping into people's profiles, public profiles being a requirement for this particular map. Saltshaker, though, showing up with 90 level 90 and 5 stars at bronze is actually kind of a Orisa one trick.
Yeah, but I mean, you say that, you know, you say
the
that
Reaper
like it's
real.
you say that like it has been affecting their gameplay that they can't play the Orisa, because overall I don't think that they've been suffering too much. Looking back, it is not weird that they play Orisa so strong, and I've just seen Razor on the Reinhardt. I would have thought I would have seen Saltshaker on something like that, but Orisa's still kind of a light projectile character, or a rapid fire projectile character, so maybe gets off with playing something along the lines of a Lucio, where they have that burst projectile type, or even a Pharah, Hanzo, something with a little bit more projectile familiarity in terms of DPS, because you know that's what this team's going to run.
Yeah, I would never accuse a team of sandbagging, but since we haven't seen Saltshaker play Orisa yet to date, you still actually can't say that. The team themselves aren't running compositions that are tank-focused, I guess is the tactful way to put it. They're definitely playing something a little angrier. Uh-oh. So this is interesting. Now, normally when a team switches to 3-3, I would say, oh, now they're going to play it safe. However, what I would argue now, what we're going to see from OTM is real talk. Like, real talk, real talk. I don't even know if Clankmeister's going to be sticking onto the Junkrat. I'm going to claim Jabait in that statement. But I feel like the bait has been taken by Obsidian, who even have a very nice 2-2 showing up. 2-2-2.
Oh, it's the turbo Jabait. They're all going to jump off of the map. That's a little disrespect.
Yeah, I didn't just get Jabaited. The entirety of Obsidian just got the gauntlet has been tossed down on the map. And yeah, they're actually going to be switching to something we're used to seeing. But Saltshaker actually now on Ashe, who gets immediately crushed by Snafu, which I'm sure was very satisfactory for them, as well as the anti-nade going in on three of their members, leading to the elimination of Razor, though Shogunai does go down to Box 6's six shooter.
Yeah, and I mean, one thing you have to consider when you take the time like that just to do something silly, or in any situation where you're taking time to make a plan, make a play, you're giving the other team advantage or positioning advantage. When they have the ability to move and you're not taking that opportunity to move, they do have the opportunity to kind of get up in your chokes as opposed, and we saw that really kind of work to the advantage of Obsidian there.
Yep, and even though I still want to say for the record, I think Obsidian got pulled into OTM's game once again. They left the point completely unattended for all that time, which is valuable ticks that they could have gotten, but instead, they're now only 6, 7, 8 seconds into the tick as Razor rips apart Snafu, and they're going to start bringing their people to bear. Here comes Clankmeister ripping down Heisenberg. And now, is the progress going to be made? Yeah, so they got a 15% advantage, but they were fighting there out in the courtyard for who knows how long.
Yeah, and now that they have that point, this point not necessarily too unfriendly for Razor on that Bastion. That being said, there's no Orisa to really kind of bunker down, but from what I've seen, Clankmeister going to be using that Hog to just body block for that Bastion as much as possible.
I love a Dynamite kill going out. That means that that perpetual damage does get through Mercy's regeneration, which as a former Mercy player is not nice to see, but as someone who hates Mercy now as a tank player, nice to see.
It's a little bit of give and take every time, but speaking of all give, no take, really, Obsidian needs to kind of pick it up here. They're not getting necessarily the value they might like to see. Bob gonna be going right off the edge, though.
Yep, and feels sad, man's shield does go down immediately, but the Snafu barrage is there and ready to go. Saltshaker does pick it up very quickly, and the Dynamite kills are massive, though, getting that nice big group together, and the ticker continues to go. Hey, we're looking at the 50% mark coming in. Wow, those Dynamites are on point with Box 6 doing some incredible work picking up the rest of those kills, now even again encroaching on that spawn.
Yeah, and Cam just having very good awareness as a player to know, hey, I'm getting really close to being lit. I know I'm in a dangerous position, but I'm going to get out of here. Getting out of there with 33, deflecting right into an Ana and Mercy's face. There's still some potential for that Genji to drop. Well done knowing when to get out.
So watch Razor setting up here. He set up right out of the spawn. He's going to find that Reinhardt before they have a chance to get in there. They are going to die for their sins, which is, you know, somewhat appropriate. But looking at Obsidian, they had what is looking like a very good ult advantage. They still have quite the advantage coming in here.
Yeah, Saltshaker been a real fiend with this Dynamite. Again, the massive burst damage that can come through with it could be a real tide turner. Especially again when you're fighting in a scattered style against a team that is very grouped up, that massive burn damage can really come through.
Yep, and with Feel Sad Man going to be touching the point just in time. Heisenberg cleaning up Razor from the point. It is going to flip out of overtime. Box 6 is finding Caustics. But the point has flipped, justifiably so. Though OTM is here to make a statement, Box 6 does go down to Snafu, though, and Snafu does not have their barrage, but it looks like they might have it very soon.
Yeah, and I think that is exactly going to be the case. Bob actually getting some kills this time around, and now it's just going to be overtime ticking down for OTM, who honestly been looking dominant once again in this map, barring a few mistakes on their own side. Not necessarily some massive capitalization coming through from Obsidian.
Yep. And there it is, the first round of the Night Market. Li Zhang Tower gonna be going to OTM. So we see what map, and it is going to be the Garden. So if there was ever a Pharah map for the respective Pharahs to flex their rockets, this is going to be Snafu's time to shine. Meanwhile, so far, I think Clankmeister is anticipating the eye in the sky.
Yeah, as much as, and I will always be the first person to praise a Pharah going into this battle, as much as I like seeing it, it's an incredibly risky play. We've seen Box 6, Saltshaker, and Clankmeister all performing on these hitscan characters to a passable degree. Having three be able to focus down onto Snafu, gonna be a risky gambit for that Aerial Queen.
Yep, so with the eye in the sky, there it is though, Heisenberg finding Cam very early on. No speed boost, no healing for you, and that is going to force the OTM to retreat just a tad to possibly flex some of that hitscan DPS that they've been rocking with. Razor setting up very quickly on the point though, and here come the kills. Snafu goes down, Heisenberg is going to find Box 6, but Bajer goes down. They grab Executioner. Bajer still very much so alive, going to be having a good time on the point. Shogunai, they get taken out by Saltshaker, who says Ashe can't win sniper duels. Bajer even finding Caustics, and now it's a definitive man advantage for OTM, with Clankmeister cleaning up a Gremlin D.Va, taking the point after a brief cap.
Yeah, and there's something about this composition. There's something about any composition that runs a massive amount of burst damage with a lot of cleanup characters that I just really like. Box 6 and Badger going to kind of synergize really well with Saltshaker and Clank if they're able to call out their heavily hit targets. If Saltshaker gets a headshot onto a squishy, or Clank really does a lot of piercing damage to a tank, those dive DPS will really be able to clean up if they're communicating well.
Speaking of which, there it is. They saw Clankmeister alone, so Feel Sodman goes diving after them, they take it, and it happens. Meanwhile, they also then go diving after Cam, and they also go down. Shocker, a Winston can handle a target who is caught alone. Snafu also finding Bokesnakes. Botcher is going to get the D-Mech onto Heisenberg, and it's going to be a little bit of a retake now, going to have to be coming in from OTM, who do find Feel Sodman, but not before they get taken out. Clankmeister does find Heisenberg on the D-Mech. And it's still going to be ticking up for Obsidian, who have taken the point in the interim with Bob now trying to, you know, clap back just a tad.
Yeah, Bob looked like he hit a table, perhaps not the exact positioning they wanted, although Bob's still getting some massive sightlines into the point. And right now, it's kind of tough. Obsidian really trying to contest the outside courtyard area as opposed to the bridge on the interior. And I don't know if that's necessarily the play, given the amount of long-range hitscan characters that are coming out here.
I think Shogunai might be enough for the moment, though. With sights up, they have proven their proficiency, at least in the slightest. They're going to find two. Razor is up, but here come the kills now for OTM. And the... Oh, Shogunai almost finds the Bastion in the back end, but it looks like it's Caustix down there with the Dragon Blade to finish off the kill. But Bok6 immediately pops his own Dragon Blade and says, "Hi, how you doing? I have a Nano Boost in the back end." He makes it so. But still, the point is in Obsidian's favor, and that's a lot of ticks coming in.
Yeah, and now I think we're kind of starting to see it swing in favor of OTM. And really, it all kind of goes off the back of that Nano Blade. Really kind of opened up the kills there once the Genji was down. Things really got cracking, but Feel Sodman really going to try to pick and recover up with that Primal.
Yeah, Razor even has to retreat and grab up a pack before he can get back into the fray. Obsidian looking very good, definitively in one fight territory, with only Razor's ultimate going to be showing any kind of claim on the point here, with a Genji going to be deflecting what they can back into it. Heisenberg finishes off the kill, and overtime has been triggered thanks to some rapid redeployment by OTM. But Obsidian is not letting up at all in the slightest, and despite Clankmeister picking up that kill, going to be difficult for them to come back in here.
Yeah, I really like the kind of focus that came through on that ulting Bastion. You had the D.Va Matrix come in, you had the Winston bubble, you had the Genji deflect getting right up in his face. Something was always dealing with that Bastion, and it really helped. I think they're learning that that's kind of where they need to focus at least a little bit. And there's nobody gonna be on point to really help secure it for OTM, even though they're really winning that fight.
Unlike a Bob, High Noon does not capture point. So there you have it. Obsidian takes a round of Lijiang Tower, moving on to the map with the pretty satellite in the sky.
Indeed, and it looks like, given last map, I'm not going to call it out, but seeing the Mei on this map makes a lot of sense. Like seeing Cam come onto that Mei from OTM, they're playing with the Reinhardt satisfactory enough. That's the most standard I think we've seen them play so far, if they go with it. That being said, I'm not entirely sure they're going to go with it. They may just hop right off the edge once again. We'll see if they do, because that kind of hindered them a little bit, but no, it doesn't seem like they will.
Yeah, their lesson may have been learned. How far can you go with the mind games before you go too far? And here we see the first shield tank coming out. Salt Shaker grabbing the Reinhardt, diving very early, going to get picked off very quickly. As they go down, but Clank, not before actually more kills even coming in. It takes a very long time for them to eliminate Salt Shaker, and that gives OTM the time to set up a definitive man advantage on the point.
Yeah, and there's a part of this that I really kind of like out of both sides running the Mei with a Bastion thrown into the mix, where Cam can give Razor the high ground, but also so can Caustix, and really make that Bastion kind of the focus fire target from Shogunai, from Snafu, from Heisenberg. So it's kind of one of those things where it's like, is the high ground more of a benefit or a hindrance in this situation? Either way, Razor not going to seem to have a problem getting these kills.
Yeah, but Shogunai also showing a proficiency for breaking up a choke. Razor going to be setting up against a Heisenberg, who we all know has a defense matrix and has a good time dealing with the Bastion, especially when backed by a Mei. At least that would normally be the case if there wasn't a Junkrat being a humongous pain in the Australian butt.
Very much so. A lot of are just one ult going to be coming through from Razor, however, and has shown that it takes a lot of resources from Obsidian to really kind of deal with that one ult. So Razor popping this might just bait, but it's not going to be a bait out all of these cooldowns from the now attacking team.
Yep, and with the May alt going in, that's going to be a very easy kill for Bodger to make, who's also playing the Zarya for the first time we've seen. Clankmeister picking up the kill, the pickup rather, on the Gremlin Baby Diva. Little bit of an overkill to use a Junkrat tire on a D-mech'd pilot, but you know, whatever it takes to get the job done.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you're going to definitely give the Diva the experience of not going four-wheeling, but just one-wheeling in this case. But, I mean, with Razor being down, they really, Obsidian, that is, really needs to kind of capitalize on that if possible. And, man, it's looking like Schaltzaker making that difficult for him.
Yeah, Schaltzaker on the Brigitte was going to do their best at the very end. Box 6 even flint snafu before they can do more of the kills, but Phil Sodman is going to grab Cam with a little bit of that boop-tastic action, and here we go. Calstix is going to throw their ult out on the field and stop this currently one-sided control tower from getting any further as the point flips to Obsidian.
Yeah, and one thing to note here, Badger caught out alone. That could be very bad for Zarya, especially going up against this one May. And Gossick's going to be taking an icicle to the head of Badger. And that's if the team of OTM is going to choose to regroup, that's going to cause them a little bit of time.
And with the ults coming online the way they are, we might be looking at a little bit of a dry push from OTM. No barriers yet. Razor with the Bastion configuration, they're going to hold on to that. Badger actually going to be switching on to a McCree for now. Cam holding out as much as they can, building up some ult percentage as they move in.
Yeah, Cam really trying to just pester Heisenberg on this Zarya. Going to be getting it, however. The Zoning Mine's coming out, taking out Saltshaker at the rally. That's fatal.
Oh, and easily one of the dirtiest hooks that I have ever seen in Overwatch history come out from Clankmeister. Grabs a fleeing Mercy, feels Sodman, gets picked up as a result. No dirty hook for the Tracer. The point does flip to OTM right after Snafu gets eliminated. Shogunai finds Box 6, though, so it's not necessarily the huge disadvantage you would think. But with the Bastion ult coming onto the field, it's going to be difficult for them to get back. And that's going to be hook, line, sinker, Lijiang Tower. End the match, going to OTM Esports.
Yeah, OTM just getting some massive value through there. I don't think that could be argued. OTM looked very dominant there. And throughout this entire series, there were some very good showings that managed to come through from Unchained Obsidian, but I just don't think that they were prepared necessarily to fight against this one particular style. And really, how many times can you say you're prepared to in general? You don't see teams run this that often unless you're in quick play.
Yep, and that's pretty much the long and short of it, but the unexpected can certainly be a weapon against the team expecting possibly the meta. We saw how quickly Obsidian tried to match them at that game, picking those DPS heroes, switching on to what seemed to be the best option, and on Lijiang Control Tower, we saw it happen in full force. Despite the May coming out from both sides, it was just a very difficult situation for Obsidian to grasp, and OTM ultimately takes it with sheer mechanical brilliance, and again, the ability to, for every player on the team, to make a difference.
Yeah, and that's really what it has to come down to when you're playing in that style. You can't play that style and just have one star player, because you can't build around that. If you play with just one star player in a comp where you're taking six different battles, yeah, the star player will win his one, but then you lose the five others if they're not carrying their weight. And, you know, it just goes to show that, as you said, these characters, or these players, rather, definitely kind of holding their own each individually, as well as a unit.
Yep, yep, yep. So there we have it. We are going to be seeing the end of this match. Don't forget to vote in that VIP, the Twitch MVP votes before the time is up. So let your voice be heard. Let us know who you think is the big player of the match. However, that being said, so we have a bit of a conundrum. We are, however, going to be seeing Obsidian dip down into the lower bracket before the match will continue for them. Meanwhile, Off the Map Esports going to be moving on to play Toronto Tide Pods. And as far as the brackets go, this is shaping up to be a pretty bizarre tournament overall, but the matches that should be coming out are going to be pretty fantastic, if I do say so myself.
Yeah, I definitely got to be on the lookout for some of the maps that are going to be coming up in the near future. Of course, as you said, it will be Off the Map playing Toronto. I'm looking forward to that game. Two teams that I know have massive potential, especially after seeing the performances they put up today. But Urgency also going to kind of be the first real litmus test we're going to be seeing against Unchained Obsidian. So here it was kind of one of those things where it's But now we're going to kind of get a genuine feel for where Unchained Obsidian is. And, you know, not that I would wish either team get knocked out, but I'm hoping we can at least see Unchained kind of show some of their true potential here. I would like to see them kind of have a very competitive game one way or another coming up. That would be on the 10th, I believe.
Truth be told, yeah, it's a nasty matchup in any event, especially when you see a team. So, you know, Urgency versus the Tide Pods, that was slightly more even, but Tide Pods still ultimately at the end of the day did 3-0 them. So, yes, yeah, Urgency put up a fantastic fight. They're going to have to take their strategies back and scout a lot harder if they're going to make a solid push for it. Meanwhile, I mean, it's... Maybe we stop ignoring the elephant in the room for a minute here. OTM completely obliterated Obsidian. And Obsidian could... So maybe Obsidian didn't run necessarily what they were planning on running. I still want to argue that they got pulled into OTM's game just a tad too much. So in the lower bracket, that could be their big chance to start making it known. Speaking of which, by the way, we're going to be looking at our MVP for the map. It's going to be Bodger.
Yeah, much congratulations out to Badger here. Going to be getting our most sincere congratulations as well as both the teams for coming out here and performing. And of course, OTM gets the big congrats for winning the round as well.
They'll be moving on to fight against the Toronto Tide Pods in the upper bracket. Meanwhile, Urgency and Obsidian going to be going down to the lower bracket to fight for their lives to make it back to the finals once again. But for now, this is it for the Overwatch Watchers Brawl tonight. We'll see you again tomorrow. This has been 3.007. You can find me on Twitch or Twitter at 3.007.
And likewise, I am Sir Waltham. You can't find me at 3.007, but you can find me at Sir Waltham Gaming on Twitter, Sir Waltham on Twitch. And again, for everybody here at the Overwatch Watchers Brawl, we want to say thank you for joining us. You guys have a great night. Thank you to all the teams who joined us today, but have a great night and stay safe, everybody.